Hey there, all my sexy Dexter fans. My name is Emily, and welcome to my very own personal kill room, in which I will deliver to you the review for the 12th and final episode of season 7. Surprise, motherfucker. So, as you can see here, got my kill suit on. I am ready to do some serious damage. And this is legitimately industrial quality. Plastic snazziness, not plastic, whatever. Plastic wrap, can't think. Yes, it's plastic. and it was interesting to hunt down. I sort of got my lizard brain was sort of flickering into action as I was hunting this stuff down. So yes, this is not just a white background, this is plastic. So it is legit. And tonight I had a little season finale party. I made red velvet cupcakes, a lot of which I ate, and I have some red bubbly that I'm going to finish as I process this episode with what's left of my soul. As you can see, I'm still awake. I don't think I'm in the afterlife yet, so if I was, then I think my camera would have better battery life, so. but in all seriousness, wow, that episode was a freaking roller coaster ride if I've ever been on one. Don't even know where to begin. How about with a spoiler alert? Because if you haven't seen this episode, you shall forever hate me for ruining the emotional newness of it for you with my own. So I give you my blessing to go elsewhere until you have actually caught up in this, because this is some serious shit. I'm just gonna tell you that much. I actually, like, in the last 5-10 minutes of the episode, I literally broke down in tears. I was holding my own for as long as I possibly could. the tremors were starting from deep within me, especially in, like, the last 10 minutes when I just knew that things were down to the wire. And wow, I don't know how many of you guys stuck around for the little 1-2 minute after interview with Scott Buck, one of the showrunners. He was talking about that scene with Deborah at the end, the one that, like, shattered my existence, by the way. Thank you very much. he's talking about how that moment was completely unscripted. I think I just spit on my camera. But that is so beautiful to me, and that is so Jennifer Carpenter, and so Deb, and just, wow, could not have been more perfect. We knew that Deborah was going to choose Dexter no matter what, but the way that she made that struggle so real and so tangible and thick, I could feel it in my living room just watching. It was phenomenal, and just, you know, I had so little sympathy for LaGuardia towards the end. You know, I'm pulling for my Dex as always, but Deborah's performance, just the way that she worked through that entire scenario, it really had me feeling so much for everyone on so many levels. And the way that Deb rushed over to LaGuardia after she shot her and held her bleeding body against her, like, I completely erupted. Little volcano of myself for, like, at least 3 minutes, just tears. Whew. Hello, Niagara Falls. It was just, wow. Words can't describe how flawless that was and how true to her character and just everything. I had actually made a prediction that Deb was going to make a kill towards the end of the season. And that much came true, but there were some other predictions that I was very wrong about, so I'm gonna try and work my way through this as best I can. So, here we go. One thing that I really appreciated about this episode, first and foremost, is just, like I said, quite a roller coaster. It really embodied the darkness that's kind of typified this season, as well as even the lightness that typified the first season. It was so nostalgic, especially all the scenes with the one and only James Doakes, who made a stellar reappearance, by the way. I actually had thought that he was going to sort of pop up as, like, another kind of hairy figure to Dexter after he's up against the wall. He's completely stuck, can't go anywhere, game over, and I imagine that Doakes was gonna bust in and kind of, like, you know, grind the dirt in his eyes a little bit more and kind of be like, you know, you thought that you could escape this, you thought you're so smart, da 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 da. And so I thought it was going to be something like that, sort of deal. But in fact, he appeared in multiple flashbacks, which I think really helped us to, you know, just see how much Dexter has grown, for one thing. Like, what a fantastic way to show the way that he's emerged. In this season, Dexter has learned so much more about humanity. He really, at least he felt that he knew nothing about it in the first season. Like, he had his masks, but they were merely masks. He thought that humanity was just happiness and smiles and donuts. He's the donut guy. But he has come to a place where he knows that it's so much more, and so it's really crazy to see that contrast, but so nostalgic, because you gotta love season one. There's no getting around it. That stuff is the bomb, and it makes me really want to rewatch the the first couple seasons as I am groping my way through this long hiatus. So really cool, really awesome to see James back on the scene. Make sure you guys listen to Scott Reynolds' Dexter Wrap-Up podcast. I'll put links in the description to that. It's free on iTunes as well as Showtime's official YouTube. They should be paying me to say this, but they're not. I just love them, so. Yeah, so definitely stick around, because guess who's going to be one of the guests? Dotes himself. So it'll be fun to hear, you know, what it's like for him, especially since, you know, Erik King, he's returning as kind of a legend. He has gotten like 10 times more popular than he even was when he was actually on the show. So it's gotta be interesting to sort of return for an encore performance, and he did so good. It was the classic James. There was one quote that I loved, and Dexter was like trying to give, he was trying to give Dokes advice about, you know, dealing with his breakup with LaGuardia way back when, and he's like, you know, don't jump the fence unless you're willing to take on what's on the other side, and Dokes is like, you know, where'd you get that? And Dex is like, oh, it's something I heard from a friend, and Dokes is just like, bullshit, you don't have any friends. It was just like, yes! I laughed so hard, and that was just something that made this episode so beautiful and fun for me, was just that it had such a humorous side. You know, the total snarkiness from Matthew's little... I liked how the New Year's party towards the end kind of did a sweeping overview of all the characters, some of whom really hadn't gotten enough screen time in this season, like Masuka, you know, to see Batista trying to convince Masuka to not try and be Baby New Year. He's like, try and stop me. I was very pleased. I would have gone to that party just for the purpose of witnessing that. I'll drink to that. Here's to you, Masuka. And please don't fall, kill room. I am not as skilled as Dexter in the art of plastic wrapping a room. So if it randomly falls, just laugh and cry with me, because, well, my scene is ruined and they'll find my DNA and I'll get caught by the cops. So that sucks. Anyways, so let's talk about the actual episode. Did I already talk about Hannah? Wow, I can't remember everything I've said. I hope I haven't, but I'll try and make a few remarks. I like that she didn't just die or peace out completely at the end of the episode. It's gonna be interesting to see her stick around for the next season. We're really seeing her true colors in the way that, like, she bit Dexter's lip at the end. It was a very kind of, it was sort of a Lila-like move, and yet it's sort of almost a way of marking her independence, and yet, after she escapes with the help of Arlene, you know, leaving the little plant on Dexter's porch, you know, she's gonna be back. And to what extent, we can't be sure, but I think it's gonna be interesting, especially as the relationship between Dexter and Deborah is being so opened up, which is another thing that I loved about this episode, is the fact that, the gates are wide open. They can go anywhere with Dex and Deb now. And a lot of people who have been interested in the idea of them being together, it's distinctly possible that the writers are still gonna play with that, because now Dexter and Deborah have been irrevocably intertwined by this tragedy. They're both coming at the issue of what happened to LaGuardia from very different places, but we see them as they're returning to the big New Year's party. We see that Deb is gently clinging on to Dexter's arm and following him on, and then things kind of fade off into the fireworks. And I was waiting for the camera to pan back down and it didn't, and I was so upset. But yet, it's the perfect ending, because now they just, the rest is still unwritten, in the words of Natasha Bedingfield. So there's just so many ways that this can go. And I just love the subtle, sweet way that things ended. Bittersweet, really, but wow, just crazy. Very, very wild the way that Dexter was arrested very early on. And so the real buildup wasn't leading to Dex getting stuck behind bars, as some of us had wondered. But it led up to Dexter having to make this break from his code, and we see him really struggling with Harry. Like when Dexter breaks into, LaGuardia's house, and Harry is like, LaGuardia doesn't even come close to fitting the code. Like, run away! Ah, my plastic is falling! Dang it! Well, this is unfortunate. I am definitely not a supreme killer, so just so you guys know. But what was I even talking about? I don't even know. But yes, Dexter's talking with Harry, and I think it was, you know, another sign that Dexter has grown so much, as he's talking about how he can't just run away, even taking Deb and Harrison, the two people that mean the most to him in the world. The life that was once fake to him has now become real, and he even references, you know, it became real when he had a son, when he married Rita. And that's a really beautiful moment for those of us who really honor that relationship and miss it being referenced and really explored in earnest, since, you know, everything has happened. So that was a really cool moment, and Dexter says he's gonna stand his ground, and the only way that he knows how to is by playing fast and loose with the code, really solidifying himself as a true serial killer. It's not the dark passenger bidding him do this, he's looking out for himself. And it's interesting how the writers kind of incorporated some parallelism between Dexter and Hannah, and how, like, in the very end, he tells Deb to do what she has to do, and how he's protecting himself, and yet still so dedicated to Deborah through and through, and it's just a very interesting couple of dichotomies that really come into play, and it was so fun and just anxiety-inducing to watch. A really funny moment when Dexter and Deborah were in the car trying to figure out what to do after LaGuardia turns the tables on Deb. That was an anxiety-inducing moment. And then you hear like the big thump, and you're like, oh no, and Deb's like, what is it? And Dex is just like, Estrada. And then Deb just gets out of the car like, I'm so done with you, bro. I just can't even. It's awesome. So I'm trying to think of other things that I was going to mention and I forgot. Again, it was really interesting to see how Dexter has been impacted by Dokes and how the writers explored that. You know, because when he's taking out Estrada, they almost have this kind of bonding moment, sort of like how Dexter got to bond with Isaac, except things definitely take a different sort of turn. But, you know, like he, the Estrada kind of asks him, you know, like, what kind of person are you? And Dexter, after remembering some situations with Dokes, where Dokes really saw into his true darkness, he's just like, I'm just a creep motherfucker. And I just, like, I laughed so hard, but it was so terrifying at that point, and just so electric and horrifying and everything, because we knew that LaGuardia was on her way, and just, I don't even, what an amazing episode. I'm jumping all over. I'm so sorry I do this to you guys all the time, but You are so supremely gracious to me, and I couldn't be more thankful for those of you who have bothered to stick around. So, do you guys have any predictions as to what could happen in the next season? Definitely a lot of questions about Dexter and Deb. Does this mean that Deb is going to become a serial killer herself? I personally don't think so, but I think that it's really going to impact their relationship in a wild way, and I can't wait to see just what the writers do. It's going to be a return to the beginning of the season where they're trying to figure each other out all over again. Dexter's going to be exploring new parts of his human side, new parts of his past, after he's finally taken out all of the people who killed his mother, which is where his darkness first began. So, really crazy stuff. I have so many other thoughts, and I'm gonna be continuing to hash things out in future vlogs. So leave all your thoughts below. Message me, follow me on Facebook, Twitter, and Tumblr. I got all the links in the description. I don't mind being stalked, because I'm more than happy to talk to you guys. In return, there's lots to say. Also, I think it's hilarious how Jamie goes to Quinn at the friggin' New Year's party. It's just like, really? Really? You have terrible taste in men. He's a drunk. It's funny. I really hope that Batista still continues to be a part of the equation. I really have grown so attached to him. He's kind of my family too. Yeah, man, I am just so thrilled about, you know, that things have been left so open-ended now, but yet, oh man, I don't know, it's a whole different kind of cliffhanger from last season, and I'm still trying to process everything, so thank you so much for watching. I'm still exploding, and I'm probably gonna watch this like 20 more times the next week, so expect another vlog, perhaps another exclusive vlog on just this one. But this just really had like tied in so many seasons together. It tied in all of the sort of loose hanging ends throughout the season itself. Thoughts pending on the entire season as a whole. It's crazy, it's crazy. I was so happy to see Dokes. I sort of have a complete and total crush on his existence. So it was great to see him. Amazing to see Deb just react so passionately, so sensitively and vulnerably the way she did. Love her to pieces, terrified of Hannah, and I love that I can finally be terrified instead of being like, who even are you? It's going to be a fantastic season to come, and it's supposed to be the last one, so what on earth are they gonna do? Is Dexter really gonna get caught? You know, especially after this whole scare at Miami Metro, and so many people reacted so violently against what LaGuardia did. So I'm gonna wrap this up. I'll be talking about more things in the future, so I hope that you enjoyed this, and let's hash this all out together, because we are all in this as a collective unit, and it is just so... I'm loving Dex again. I love that we got to see that kind of serial killer snarkiness that he had in the first season, that we got to see those flashbacks, the way that he's grown and he's becoming human and he's feeling and all this stuff. I love it. It's so good. So good. This is my show and my life. And I pretty much am going to have no life for like the next few months. So I love you guys so much. Time for me to take down this insanity, and that's all behind me before it like caves in on me. So thanks for watching, y'all. I will continue to keep you updated on my thoughts. Share with me your theories, any questions, concerns, whatever. I'm all ears, so thank you for sticking around, and I'll be back in a jiff with more Dexter vlogs in the upcoming weeks. And a preemptive Merry Christmas to you. And let us talk in the comments, and I am dragging this out for forever and a day, so tonight's the night. And there shall be others in the coming year. So take care, y'all.